God has designed us to be social beings, to varying extents. Some people are introverts, and some people are extroverts. Some people need lots of human company, while others are pretty good by themselves for long periods. But we all need some kind of human interaction. And it seems like this is becoming something of a problem in the 21st century. It seems that we're struggling to make the meaningful connections that we crave. Loneliness is becoming rife. According to a 2018 survey by The Economist, nearly a quarter of adults in the United States and the United Kingdom say they often feel lonely, lack companionship, or feel isolated. These figures are stark, but they're not as shocking as a Cigna study of 20,000 Americans in the same year that discovered nearly half always or sometimes felt alone. 54% in the same study said they don't have anyone in their life who knows them well. 43% said they feel isolated from others. Meanwhile, a 2018 UK survey by the BBC revealed a third of Britons very often feel lonely. We often think of loneliness as being an affliction of old age, and that's true. The BBC survey discovered that loneliness affects nearly half of Britons over 65, many of whom consider television or a pet to be their main source of company. But loneliness affects the young too. People in the 16 to 24 year old age bracket are actually the most likely to report feelings of social isolation. Almost two-thirds say they feel lonely some of the time, and nearly a third say they feel lonely all of the time. According to Relate, loneliness is on the rise too. In 2015, 1 in 10 people said they had no close friends at all, but that rose to 1 in 8 by 2018. That's 7 million adults in the UK without any close friends. I'm actually making this series during the coronavirus outbreak too, which obviously means that people are being forced to stay inside right now, and that's cutting off normal human contact, and this is no doubt adding hugely to these feelings of isolation and loneliness that people feel in the world today. If we take a mean average of all the varying statistics that I just went through, we can very roughly say that in Western society, around one-third of the adult population is currently struggling with isolation and loneliness, a very significant number. And this is a huge problem because the evidence tells us that loneliness is hugely damaging to our health and our happiness. In fact, loneliness is even deadly. A major study at Brigham Young University in Utah recently examined 3.4 million people and discovered that risk of early death increases by 26% in those who experience chronic loneliness. This makes loneliness about as deadly as smoking, drug abuse, or obesity. Indeed, Harvard University quantifies it by saying that loneliness has about the same risk factor as smoking 15 cigarettes a day and is likely to reduce one's lifespan by about 8 years. The lead author of the Brigham Young study, Julianne Holt-Lundstad, said, "Substantial evidence now indicates that individuals lacking social connections are at risk for premature mortality. The risk with social isolation and loneliness is comparable with well-established risk factors for mortality, including obesity and substance abuse." Now, one remarkable reason for early death is that loneliness has been discovered to have a visible, measurable, destructive effect on the very cells in our body. Cells are the building blocks of every living thing. In the human body, we have 37.2 trillion of them. And in 2015, UCLA scientists discovered that loneliness damages these cells and impairs their very function. The team reported that isolation triggers cellular changes that result in chronic inflammation in the body. Indeed, if you were to take the top 5% of people in the United States with the most expensive chronic conditions, you would discover that 55% of them are also experiencing chronic loneliness. It's intrinsically connected, loneliness and poor health. Loneliness literally triggers cellular changes in the body that predispose people towards sickness, disease, and other serious physical conditions. And that means the lonely are far more likely to experience things like heart attacks, strokes, metastatic cancer, and Alzheimer's disease. And on top of this, loneliness means that those who do suffer such health problems are far less likely to recover afterwards. A team of scientists at Copenhagen University looked at the health outcomes of 13,433 people who had suffered heart attacks. Now, women who had described themselves as lonely were 3 times more likely to die within the year compared to those who had an active social life. Men were twice as likely to die within the year. Loneliness truly makes us sick. It destroys the very fabric of our bodies. It weakens our resilience to disease, disease, and it takes years off of our lives. Of course, what's more pertinent for this series is how loneliness affects our mental health, how it creates anxiety and depression, and the connection between loneliness and depression is so well established that scientists say that one is almost always a symptom and a predictor of the other. So if somebody's lonely, they will soon become depressed, and if somebody's depressed, they will soon become lonely. The two kind of feed off each other and create a downward spiral. In Australia and New Zealand, scientists actually consider loneliness to be the primary predictor of suicide in the elderly. The most important study on loneliness and mental health comes from Harvard University. Back in 1938, they started tracking the lives of 268 of their students, and this they continued to do after graduation and for the rest of their lives. Indeed, the study then continued in their offspring and in their offspring and into other city residents, meaning that at the time of making the series, it has spanned multiple generations and over 1,300 people. It's a very unique study. Now, some of these individuals became businessmen and doctors and lawyers, while others became schizophrenics and alcoholics. But what the Harvard team have discovered is telling. Having tracked every element of their lives, their triumphs, their failures, their careers, their marriages, every element, they realized that when all was said and done, social connections were the single most important predictor of sustained mental health and happy life outcomes. This is the fourth director of the study, Robert Waldinger, describing the findings.
What have we learned? What are the lessons that come from the tens of thousands of pages of information that we've generated on these lives? Well, the lessons aren't about wealth or fame or working harder and harder. The clearest message that we get from this 75-year study is this: good relationships keep us happier and healthier, period. We've learned three big lessons about relationships. The first is that social connections are really good for us and that loneliness kills. It turns out that people who are more socially connected to family, to friends, to community, are happier, they're physically healthier, and they live longer than people who are less well connected. And the experience of loneliness turns out to be toxic. People who are more isolated than they want to be from others find that they are less happy, their health declines earlier in midlife, their brain functioning declines sooner, and they live shorter lives than people who are not lonely. And the sad fact is that at any given time, more than 1 in 5 Americans will report that they're lonely. And we know that you can be lonely in a crowd and you can be lonely in a marriage. So the second big lesson that we learned is that it's not just the number of friends you have, and it's not whether or not you're in a committed relationship, but it's the quality of your close relationships that matters. It turns out that living in the midst of conflict is really bad for our health. High conflict marriages, for example, without much affection, turn out to be very bad for our health, perhaps worse than getting divorced. And living in the midst of good, warm relationships is protective. Once we had followed our men all the way into their 80s, we wanted to look back at them at midlife and to see if we could predict who was going to grow into a happy, healthy octogenarian and who wasn't. And when we gathered together everything we knew about them at age 50, it wasn't their middle-aged cholesterol levels that predicted how they were going to grow old. It was how satisfied they were in their relationships. The people who were the most satisfied in their relationships at age 50 were the healthiest at age 80.
Let's just take that in. The longest running study ever conducted on the subject has told us that if we want a long, happy, healthy life, then good social connections are paramount. Above everything else, above money, above fame, if you want to be happy, we need good fellowship. And it's for this reason then that we need to prioritize building relationships and investing in those relationships so that they become good quality relationships. We need to invest in the people around us, in your wife, your husband, your kids, your parents, your friends, your community. Investing in the people around us should be our priority if we want to be happy. Indeed, loving those people should be our priority if we want to be happy. And what does love look like? It looks like sacrifice. It looks like putting someone else before yourself. There's a self-love movement that has gained traction in recent years, and it tells people that if they want to be happy, they need to spend more time loving themselves, indulging themselves, focusing on themselves, giving pleasure to themselves. This is considered wisdom today, to love yourself. And obviously it's a very appealing idea because it fits the hedonic theory. But science has come along and said, nah, the path to happiness isn't loving yourself more. The path to happiness is loving others more. If you love others more and strengthen your relationships with the people around you, if you focus on them, that is the single biggest predictor of how happy you're going to be in the years ahead. How you love others will determine your future happiness. And what does loving other people involve? It involves discipline and sacrifice and discomfort, putting other people before yourself. Loving your kids means forgoing an extra hour of sleep on a Saturday morning to take them to football practice. Loving your spouse means making them dinner when you'd rather be watching TV, and defrosting their car in the morning when you'd rather be inside in bed, and agreeing to join them on an activity when you don't really want to. To love someone in righteousness means to sacrifice your will to put them first. Which is why we don't really want to do it.
So, this message that good, close relationships are good for our health and well-being, this is wisdom that's as old as the hills. Why is this so hard to get and so easy to ignore? Well, we're human. What we'd really like is a quick fix, something we can get that'll make our lives good and keep them that way. Relationships are messy and they're complicated, and the hard work of tending to family and friends, that's not sexy or glamorous. It's also lifelong. It never ends.
Do you see what he's saying? He's saying the reason that we don't take this path of righteousness is because it is difficult and it does require a lifetime of sacrifice and discipline. We'd rather get the happiness in an easier way somehow over here, in a more self-indulgent way. But happiness simply doesn't exist over there. Happiness exists down the path of righteousness. This is the path that we need to take. The Harvard study concludes by saying that tending your relationships is actually a form of self-care. The more you invest in the people around you and the more that you love the people around you, the more that you pour out your life for them, the happier and the healthier you're going to be. It's so counterintuitive, but it's true. Now, you might be noticing a pattern here when I say that the Bible has been explicitly encouraging social connection, community, and sacrificial love for thousands and thousands of years. Indeed, it puts loving fellowship at the very core of the Christian life. Here are some verses that demonstrate what Christian community looks like. First of all, the Bible repeatedly tells us to love one another. It says, "This is the message you have heard from the very beginning, we should love one another." Jesus said that love should be sacrificial, saying, "This is my commandment, love each other in the same way I have loved you." Of course, Jesus loved us by giving up his life for us. There's nothing more sacrificial than that. Paul also says, "Let no one seek his own good, but the good of his neighbor." In Ephesians 5, we are told how husbands and wives should sacrifice for each other in love, putting each other's needs ahead of their own. The Bible gives us insight into what church community should look like as well. In Hebrews we read, "And let us not neglect our meeting together, as some people do, but encourage one another, especially now that the day of his return is drawing near." Meeting together is a core part of the Christian life. We're given descriptions of what that core part of life looked like in the early church too. The Bible says all the believers devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship and to sharing in meals, including the Lord's Supper and to prayer. The believers were regularly going to one another's homes to share in meals. It brings to mind cozy evenings, laughter and joy. They devoted themselves to this. They devoted themselves to each other. The Bible says that Christian fellowship is about mutual encouragement too. It says, "So encourage each other and build each other up, just as you are already doing." It says that true Christian fellowship is about sharing with each other, offering support too. It says, "And all the believers met together in one place and shared everything they had. They sold their property and possessions and shared the money with those in need. They worshiped together at the temple each day, met in homes for the Lord's Supper, and shared their meals with great joy and generosity, all the while praising God and enjoying the goodwill of all the people. And each day, the Lord added to their fellowship, those who were being saved. Christian fellowship is about working together for the gospel side by side. It says, let us think of ways to motivate one another to acts of love and good works. True Christian fellowship is about deep discussion and growth. It says, as iron sharpens iron, so a friend sharpens a friend. True Christian fellowship is about accountability and deep authenticity. It says, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The earnest prayer of a righteous person has great power and produces wonderful results. So you can see from these verses and many more that God is intensely concerned that we have deep social connections and community. He wants us to love one another sacrificially, whether that be in church, in marriages and friendships, or in families. The Bible's been telling us to do this for thousands and thousands of years. Now, does the Bible say, love others because that will make you happy? No, it doesn't say that. That isn't the Bible's focus. The Bible tells us to love one another sacrificially and to build relationships simply because it's the righteous thing to do. It's right that we love one another in the same way that God loves us. However, it just so happens that if we do follow this righteous teaching, and if we do love one another as we should, and in a sacrificial way, we will indeed become happier as a result. Science is beginning to uncover this. Again, it's not instinctive. When we look at the righteous path of loving others, it seems messy and it requires effort and discomfort and sacrifice and discipline. But pour yourself out for others and you will be happier. Focus on loving yourself, as the hedonic theory suggests, and you're just going to become more isolated, lonely, anxious, depressed, and have worse health. Science proves this. Indeed, in 2019, Pew Research completed a study involving 26 countries and concluded, people who are active in religious congregations tend to be happier and are more civically engaged than either religiously unaffiliated adults or inactive members of religious groups. They found that a big reason why Christians are indeed happier is exactly because they do focus more on loving others and have more community. They discovered that apart from weekly church activities, 58% of Christians also volunteer their time for charities, sports clubs, or other organizations, while only 39% of atheists do the same thing. So this plays out in real life that Christians are happier in part because they love more and because they have more community. It's difficult to break the cycle of isolation. The first step's actually the hardest here because there's a stigma to admitting loneliness. Social anthropologist Kate Fox says, we have a desperate need for social contact and emotional bonding, but we cannot simply acknowledge this need and get on with the pursuit of human warmth and intimacy in a natural, straightforward fashion. She says, we have a deeply ingrained instinct to hide our loneliness from each other and says, we have to disguise our craving for social contact as a burning desire to throw balls at each other or to perfect our flower arranging or motorcycle maintenance skills or to save the whales or the world or something. But that's actually a good way, I think, to start making social connections. Do join clubs and do volunteer for things and most of all, do attend church. It's actually not completely uncommon for Christians to not bother going to church. They think it's a superfluous aspect of the Christian life. They don't really need to go to church, but it's actually a central core key part of the Christian life. Don't give up the habit of meeting together, as Hebrews says, as some are in the habit of doing. If you want to find Christians nearby, you can make use of the Fuel Network, which is available at this address. I'll put the link down below too. But whatever steps you take next, do start investing in community, in the people around you. Do start making a conscious effort to love people sacrificially. Both the Bible and science tells us it'll make you happier and it'll make you healthier.